I invite you to open your Bibles today with me again to the book of 2 Samuel, and I want you to look at 2 Samuel chapter number 2. 2 Samuel chapter 2, in just a moment we're going to read the first three verses. I'm excited about this sermon today. I'm usually excited about every sermon that I preach because I love to preach, but I really am thrilled about the sermon today because I need it. Now, there may not be anyone else in the audience today that needs this sermon, but I'll guarantee you that I do. Those of you who know me well, you know that I can get lost anywhere. Seriously, anywhere. I mean, it's amazing the places where I can get lost. You know, maps help most people, but maps just confuse me. I go out on a faith visit on Monday night, and I'm wondering, Kathy, why'd you give me this map? I carry Mike Owens along with me just so I won't get lost. Several years ago, a family in our church, not long after I'd gotten here, they gave me a gift, and that gift was to send me to the Holy Land. And that family knew me well, and not only did they pay my way to go to the Holy Land, but they also paid Bruce Raley's way as well. Now, they didn't pay Bruce's way because they loved him like me. They paid his way because they wanted to make sure that I made it back to Panama City. I just get lost so easily. Several years ago, Karen and I were teaching at a marriage seminar over in Destin. And when the conference had concluded, we went to dinner with some of the people that had attended that seminar. And we were sitting there in the restaurant, and I asked the waitress where the restroom was. She told me, and I thought I was following directions. And so I followed what I thought were her directions. And as I walked into the restroom, I noticed it rather odd because I did not see the normal things that you see in the men's room. And then when I went up to the sink and I noticed these dainty little vases with pink flowers in them, I almost fainted. I was in the ladies' room, alone, praise God. But I can get lost anywhere. I get lost at airports. I get lost at hotels. I get lost in elevators coming out. On more than one occasion, I have walked out of a department store at the mall, and I was close to calling 911 and reporting that my car had been stolen because I could not find it. I'm convinced that if ducks had my sense of direction, they would spend their winters at the North Pole. I mean, I have a hard time with that, and I can identify with Columbus as they say that when he left, he didn't know where he was going. When he got there, he didn't know where he was. And when he got back home, he didn't know where he'd been. Well, that's kind of the way that I feel. And I'm excited about this sermon today because this sermon deals with direction. And most importantly, direction as it relates to the will of God. And so as we continue our study today through the life of David, I want to think about this subject: David, us, and the will of God. And I want you to look in 2 Samuel chapter 2, and we'll begin reading at verse number 1. In verse 1 it says, "And it came to pass after this that David inquired of the Lord, saying, Shall I go up into any of the cities of Judah? And the Lord said unto him, Go up. And David said, Whither shall I go up? And he said, Unto Hebron. So David went up thither, and his two wives also, Hinnom the Jezreelitess, and Abigail, Nabal's wife, the Carmelite. And his men that were with him did David bring up, every man with his household, and they dwelt in the cities of Hebron. And then verse 4 just simply says, And the men of Judah came, and there they anointed David king over the house of Judah." Now, after the Bible says in verse 1 that it came to pass after this, and after what? Well, after the mourning that David was expressing over the death of King Saul. And so the Bible says that after he got over his mourning of the death of Saul, that he realized that it was time now in his life for the next piece of the agenda concerning the will of God for him was to take place, and that was his ascension to the throne. And we could say that at this point that the fugitive years for David were over. He had been running now for quite a few years trying to escape this monster by the name of Saul. Those years were over, as well as the time when he had been told that he was going to become king. Now that time was over, and in reality he was about to become king, because he had moved now from the place of, you might say, the king in waiting to the king in reality. And it's at this point in David's life where I think that we learn some amazing principles concerning the will of God. How can we know the will of God? How can we find the will of God? How ought we to seek the will of God? Should the will of God be a priority in our lives? And I think that all of these things are pointed out in the life story of David here at this point. Now, as we begin this whole idea concerning the will of God, I want to make four statements. And the first statement is the preparing for the will of God. I have never met anyone in my life who did the will of God that there was not a time of preparation for them. And that's exactly what we see in the life of David here, because much had occurred since that time that David had been summoned from the fields as a shepherd boy, where he was watching over the flocks of his father, and had been anointed in private by Samuel, telling him that he was going to be the next king of Israel. So much had happened during that 12-year span. For most of that time, he was literally running from his life. I mean, it was really a painful 12 years for King David. And yet, what we learn is that all of those things that befell him during that time, all of those heartaches, all of those painful experiences were simply a preparation period in which God was getting him ready to fulfill his ultimate will for him, and that was to be the next king of Israel. Now, friend, I've discovered that whenever God calls us to a place in his will, whenever God calls us and he's about to place us down in a position to carry out the will of God, there is always a preparation period. There is always a time in which God might take us into different schools of life where he can train us to do that which is the will of God. See, God never places us in a position to carry out his will that we have not been equipped for, that we have not been trained for. And sometimes when we become aware that God has set us apart for the purpose of doing something important in the will of God, sometimes if we're not careful, ego will rise up. You know, we'll get inflated with self-importance. And when that happens, God has to strip away that stuff, because he realizes that there is nothing that will hinder us from doing the will of God like ego. And so what God will do is God will put us in a training period. And you know, sometimes it may be for several years, sometimes it may be for many years. Sometimes that school of training may be quite painful, but yet God knows exactly what he needs to do to get the stuff out of our lives in order that we can fulfill what is the will of God. You know, there's so many things in our lives that God has to take away that isn't there before we can do his will. You know, there are times that God has to take away our inability so he can give us his ability. And there are times that God has to take away our foolishness so he can give unto us his wisdom. There's times that God has to take away our immaturity so he can give us maturity. There are times that God has to strip us of our carnality so he can replace it with his spirituality. And God knows exactly what it's going to take to get us to the place in life where he can use us to be productive citizens in the kingdom of God. And that is why we go through these times of preparation in life. Now, if you're a child of God today, you've truly been saved by the grace of God, and you find yourself in a tight spot, and you wonder, why is it that I am here? You realize that you might be in that tight spot today because God is preparing you for the ultimate purpose of fulfilling his will for your life. And so you feel like you're in a tight spot because God's hemmed you in. God's kind of pressed you down. God's kind of working on your life and in your life, stripping away those things that are going to hinder you from doing the will of God. And friend, I just want to stop and say right here, there is no greater joy in life than finding the will of God and doing it. And I wonder how many of us actually ever get to that point in life where we can say, I am so content because I know right now I am smack dab in the center of the will of God for my life. And dear friend, if you do not know that, I want to challenge you and show you in just a few moments that you ought to not stop until you discover exactly what it is and then begin to do it with all of your heart, which is the will of God. So number one, the preparing for the will of God. But secondly, the seeking of the will of God. Now, in verse number one, it says, and it came to pass after this. After what? After he had just mourned the death of Saul. It came to pass after this that then David began to inquire of the Lord. Now why did David do that? Because David knew that when Saul was dead, that meant that now he was going to be elevated, he was going to ascend the throne, now he was going to realize God's will for his life. We have to recognize that at this point that David was living in a little town that was called Ziklag, and we know that Ziklag was a city that was in enemy territory, and so it was obvious that David had to leave Ziklag if he was going to sit on the throne and rule over the nation of Israel. And so as he realized that, what did he do? He sought the will of God for his life. Now, there are two things that I want to say about seeking the will of God. Number one is the wisdom of seeking the will of God. Did you get that? The wisdom of seeking the will of God. Now, make no mistake about it. When it came to David trying to understand what he was to do, what his next step in life was going to be, that he sought direction from Almighty God. You know, he was wise, because why in the world would we not want to seek the wisdom and the counsel and the guidance of God? Friend, I want to ask you this morning, who can guide us any better than God? Who can reveal to us what our next step ought to be better than God? Who can show us what the path of life ought to be better than God? And so David understood that God was this perfect God. This God was infallible in all of his wisdom. And so he came to him and he sought wisdom from this God as to what he ought to do. Now, friend, I want to tell you what deeply concerns me today is that I find a lot of Christians today, they are seeking all kinds of sources in life, knowing what to do rather than seeking the wisdom of God. You know, I was talking to a Christian the other day, and they were telling me that one of the things that they did every morning was they got up, they opened the newspaper, and they read their horoscope. Dear God, you know, what can a horoscope say to you? Friend, I want you to know that that's nothing but demonic in nature. You have the living God living on the inside of you, and you're going to seek some kind of a horoscope? Or go to other sources to try to find what you ought to do with your next step in life. You know, maybe that explains so many of our problems and so many of our troubles, because we're not seeking the right source to know what it is that we ought to do in life. I love that verse that Paul writes over in the book of Ephesians chapter 5 and verse number 17, when he says, "Be ye therefore wise, understanding what the will of God is. Be ye therefore wise." And if you want to be wise, you will understand what the will of God is. In other words, Paul said, the most unwise thing you can do is to fail to understand what the will of God is. You realize that the greatest education in the world is to be educated in an understanding of the will of God. And the greatest display of ignorance in the world comes through those who are highly intelligent, but they have no clue about the will of God. You realize that a person can be most educated and most ignorant at the same time? You know, a person that does not have the will of God contained in their curriculum of study, friend, they are in reality ignorant. Because the Bible says true wisdom is understanding and knowing what the will of God is. And so I want to just simply stop and say this. If you want to be a wise person in life, seek the will of God. If you really want to have true understanding in life, seek the will of God. Why? Because it is the will of God that reveals to us basically everything that is important in life. All that we need to know can be found through an understanding of the will of God. So we see, first of all, the wisdom of seeking the will of God. But secondly, the waiting in seeking the will of God. Now, it was obvious, as I mentioned earlier, David was at Ziklag. If you listen to me, say amen. So he was at Ziklag, so it was obvious that he needed to leave. He couldn't remain in that place. But what just so blesses my heart is that even though everything logically told David, you need to leave Ziklag, he wouldn't take one step until he sought the counsel of God. You see, he'd already made that mistake before. Remember a few chapters earlier, he had not sought the will of God and the guidance of God and had gone on down into the Philistine country of Gath and had gotten into serious trouble. And he said, you know what? I'm not going to get ahead of God again. I'm not going to make that mistake twice, but I'm going to wait on God. I know it looks like I ought to leave, but I'm not going to take a step until God reveals to me that I need to leave. Now, friend, if we would just learn that one little principle right there, you want to know why some of us today can't seem to find ourselves living in the will of God? Because we don't have the patience to wait on God. I mean, we just got to do something. We just have to take a step. We just have to move forward. We just have to do something. And sometimes the most spiritual thing we could do is nothing but wait. And David said, you know what? I'm not going to take a step. I'm going no place. I'm not going to act until I get a word from God as to what I need to do. But Pastor, what if God doesn't give me a word? Oh, if you belong to Him, He'll give you a word. You never have to worry about that. Friend, I don't know if you've ever thought about this or if you've ever seen this, but I'm about to share something with you here that is of vital importance. And if you get a hold of this, I'm telling you, it will change your life. When we consider how desolate and desperate the situation was in David's life, where he was at that point, and yet he was willing to stay there until God told him to leave, man, that is something to be commended. I want you to look back in 1 Samuel chapter 30. Let me show you that a moment. 1 Samuel chapter 30. Remember, he's at Ziklag. Every evidence is, man, he needs to get out of that place. But in verse number 1 it says, "And it came to pass, when David and his men were come to Ziklag on the third day, that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag, and had smitten Ziklag, and had burned it with fire." Remember, they had moved down to Ziklag, all of his family, all of his friends and his followers, and then they had gone off on this military excursion. And while they were gone, the Amalekites came to Ziklag and burned the city down. So Ziklag was a desolate city. It had been burned to the ground. There was nothing that was standing. And even though he was living in the midst of ruins, he would not leave that place until he got a word from God to leave. Now, friend, I want to tell you, it is not easy staying. When staying means living in an undesirable situation. It's not easy to do, is it? And I find that sometimes we find ourselves in a comfortable situation, and we do not want to leave that because of the comfort, even though leaving is the will of God. And sometimes we are in an uncomfortable situation, and we want to leave that to escape the discomfort, even when leaving is not the will of God. Now, friend, I just want to tell you, and I want to counsel you, listen and listen carefully. If you are in a tough situation today, if you are living in a difficult place, listen, if you find yourself living in the midst of Ziklag, let's say, you better not take a step to get out until God tells you to leave. And God will always give you a word. So many times we think that the will of God is dictated and determined by our circumstances. And friend, nothing is further from the truth. I find so many people today, when they are trying to discern the will of God, they filter everything through some kind of bad circumstances. Well, if it's bad, if it's uncomfortable, if it's bringing pain, then obviously this is not the will of God for my life. Friend, if you're in a zigzag place today, you better hold on before you step out. Because a lot of times we find ourselves getting in serious trouble as it relates to the will of God because we simply don't have the patience to wait on the Lord. You know, dear friend, I've never lost anything by waiting on God. But I've lost just about everything by stepping out and getting ahead of God. So don't you do that. You know, David gives us a good example here. Friend, listen, you realize that there are some pastors who have left Ziklag churches long before they should have, and they found themselves in a worse situation later. There have been husbands and wives who have left Ziklag marriages long before God said go, later on to regret it. There have been people that have left Ziklag jobs, jobs that God gave them in the first place, to find out that the grass wasn't always greener on the other side of the fence. What I'm simply saying is God has a will. God has a will for your life up in the balcony. God has a will for your lives on the main floor. God has a will for your life in the choir and your life in the orchestra. God has a will for all of our lives. But yet God's will is very seldom determined by the comfort or the discomfort of our circumstances and our situation. And you see, dear friend, what we need to do is we need to do like David. David did not allow his travel plans to be dictated by how he felt or his surroundings. His travel plans were dictated by a word from God. God spoke to David's heart. I don't know how God spoke to him. I don't know if God spoke in an audible voice, but God speaks today. God speaks in His Word today, doesn't He? And if we ever expect to hear the Word of God concerning the will of God, then we're going to have to spend time getting into the Scriptures so we can discern the voice of God when God does speak. So the seeking of the will of God. Let me ask you, are you seeking God's will for your life? I mean, really, is it a passionate pursuit of yours? Or is the will of God something that's just, you know, out there in the blue somewhere? Something that's this intangible thing that you cannot get a hold of? Friend, God has a will, and He has a will for your life as well. So the preparing for the will of God, the seeking of the will of God, but thirdly, the learning of the will of God. I've discovered in my own personal experience that the will of God is something that has to be learned. It's not something that is just, boom, revealed overnight. And I want to show you how David learned the will of God. Number one is there was a progression, a progression. Now look in verse 1, the B part of that verse, the Bible says, "And so the Lord said unto David, go up." So David had asked the Lord, what am I to do? And the Lord said, go up. So then David comes back and he asks another question. He said, whither shall I go up? And then the Lord said unto him, unto Hebron. Do you notice the progression there? God didn't say to David immediately, go on up to Hebron. He gave him general revelation at first concerning the will of God, and then he gave him more specific revelation. A progression. And you see, the longer that he sought the will of God, then he came to the place of understanding it because it was a progressive thing. I don't know about you, but some of you that have been walking with the Lord for a long time, I think that I could get a hearty amen from you with this statement. I've discovered that the will of God is something where when God begins to speak to my heart, first of all, he's going to show me something generally. And then as I follow that general revelation, then he's going to give me something more specific. He shows me the path, but then he shows me the individual steps along that path. Now why does God do that? Because God wants us to take one step at a time so that we are trusting in him, depending on him, growing in our faith that we exercise in him. You see, God gives us enough revelation to show us what we ought to do in the present, but very seldom does God show us 5 years or 10 years down the road. When it comes to the will of God, man, we want it all at once. God just dumped the barrel on me. But God doesn't do that. God just puts out little droppers and little revelations, and we follow that. And then we come to the point where we're living in the center of the will of God. I think back about my conversion experience. I was 21 years old and just as lost as a goose. And I remember that God began to stir my heart about my need for him. And the Holy Spirit was working in my life. And so I was thinking about my need for God. And God began to reveal to me step by step how I could come to know him. And God's first revelation of the first step that I was to take was simply to go to church. Now, God didn't tell me anything else. Just go to church. So I went to church. And after several months of being in church, in Sunday school, and in worship services where the Word of God could prepare my heart, then God told me to take a second step. And that is when the invitation was given that I was to go forward and I was to tell the pastor that I wanted to be saved. And then God told me the third step. And the third step was that I was just to ask Jesus Christ to come into my heart and to forgive me of my sins. And I got saved. But friend, I got saved by following God one step at a time. It was God's will for me to be saved. And by the way, it's God's will for you to be saved as well. But I never would have been saved if I was looking forward to the third step. I had to take the first step and the second step before I ever arrived at the third step. And friend, that's the way it always works. And do you realize that after we are born again, that's the way it works as well in us coming to understand what the will of God is? Listen, we never leap into the will of God. We step into the will of God. And it's one step at a time. And as we take that step, we remain faithful where we are until God gives us more revelation. Then we take another step and we remain faithful where we are and God gives us more revelation. Friend, I want to tell you need to know how to discern what the will of God is for your life. So we see then the learning of the will of God, and it involves a progression. But secondly, it involves a persistence. A persistence. Now, in verse number 1, it says, "And it came to pass after this, that then David inquired of the Lord, saying, Shall I go up? And the Lord said, Go up." Now, David didn't stop there. He comes back, and he says, "Where shall I go up?" And he says, "Go unto Hebron." In other words, he was persistent in asking questions of God. Friend, do you realize God is not wearied of our asking? As a matter of fact, God is never more pleased than when we are asking. And we are never better equipped not to miss the will of God when we are asking. You know, as the old hymn says, "Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer." The idea of persistently asking the Lord over and over and over again. Because as we are living in persistence, listen, our focus and our attention is upon God. It's not upon us. It's not upon our surroundings or our circumstances, but it's upon him. And when we get our focus in that direction, it is a lot harder to miss what the will of God is for our lives. You know, I have learned over the years that we will persist in what we value. Would you agree with that? That which we value, we will persist in finding it or getting a hold of it. You know, I remember back when I first met that sweet little thing, Karen Richardson. with the sexy legs who would one day become my bride. I say things like that just to make sure you're listening. And don't turn red, dear. And I remember that, man, I was persistent in my pursuit of her. I mean, there was no time too valuable for me to give up for her. There was no hamburger too expensive for me to buy for her. Man, I pursued her. And I pursued her with a persistence. Listen, I care deeply for her. I could not imagine her living her life without me. It would be so tragic. And so I went after him because of my persistence. I got her. And I've had her now for 35 years. And I'm going to keep her for another 35 years. I'm going to outdo Brother Stan and Miss Mildred. We're going to celebrate 80 years of marriage one day. Friend, would you not agree that that which we ought to value more than anything in life is the will of God? What is more important than the will of God? Every good thing in life is connected to the will of God. Every joy, every blessing, every happiness, every fulfillment is connected to the will of God. Then would you not agree that we ought to persistently pursue the will of God until we know it? Had David not pursued the will of God here by asking God over and over and over again, he would have lacked in his knowledge of what the will of God was for him. For now, I wish that we as a church family could get to this point where every decision that we made, we would filter that decision through the will of God. Let me ask you, were you asked to make a decision last week that had to do maybe with your job or with a relationship or with finances? Did you ever stop and just ask, what is the will of God? If we could filter every decision through, what is the will of God? But in order to be able to do this, you know what we've got to do? We've got to know the Word of God. Because the Word of God never violates the principles of the will of God. And so if we're going to be pursuing the will of God, at the same time, we've got to be pursuing a knowledge of the Word of God. Now, friend, I just want to tell you, I love you with all of my heart. But don't you tell me today that you really are concerned about the will of God if you spend no time in the Word of God. You really are not that concerned. If we really are concerned with the will of God, we will bathe our souls in the Word of God. We're going to get up in the morning, man, and we're going to read the Bible. We're going to have a strong devotional life. We're going to know what God says. And as we know what God says, then we come up to those decisions in life that we've got to make, you know, like on the spur of the moment, then our involuntary response to what that decision is going to be based on a principle of God's Word that we have learned. And if we do that so many times, that will keep us out of deep trouble. So the learning of the will of God. And then last of all, the doing of the will of God. You know, what is our purpose for learning about the will of God? Is it so that we can add to our intellectual knowledge? The purpose of learning the will of God is for living the will of God. The purpose for discovering the will of God is for doing the will of God. Practical application is always the primary purpose of divine revelation. Why does God divinely reveal us anything about his will? Because he wants us to do it. And there are two things that stick out so clearly here about David's doing of the will of God. Number one was his promptness. Down in verse 2, the A part of that verse, after God told him to go up to Hebron, the Bible says in verse 2, so David went up there. It was immediate obedience. See, David didn't do like a lot of us do. A lot of us know what the will of God is, and we delay in our doing. Do you realize that when we delay doing the will of God, that is really disobedience to the word and the will of God? Who in the world are we to say no to God? When God reveals His will to us, that is the best for our lives, that will bring joy and happiness and peace and contentment and fulfillment and will build the kingdom, who are we to delay? But we do. Friend, don't be like your pastor. I knew God's will for my life was to preach the gospel, and I delayed for 5 years, five of the most miserable years of my life. So when God reveals something to you that is His will, don't delay, but do it, and do it right then. Do you realize that the timing of our obedience reflects the quality of our obedience? If you heard that, say amen. The timing of our obedience reflects the quality of our obedience, and the timing of our obedience determines the quality and the quantity of God's blessings. See, we want God to bless without delay, but we don't want to obey without delay. And it doesn't work that way. If we want God to bless us without delay, then we've got to obey God without delay. I wonder how many blessings of God are missing from our lives because of delayed obedience to the will of God. So there was the promptness of His doing the will of God, and secondly, the benefits of His doing the will of God. Do you realize that I think that our obedience to the will of God determines whether we are a blessing or a burden to those around us? Our obedience to the will of God determines if we're going to be a blessing or we're going to be a burden. So when David obeyed the will of God, first of all, his family was blessed. In verse 2, so David went up there and his two wives also. We'll say more about this later on. They went up to Hebron along with him. So his family was blessed because he took his family. When he obeyed the will of God, he moved them out of Ziklag, the desolate place, and moved them into Hebron, which was a place of blessing. Pastor, how is the best way that I can be a blessing to my family? Listening, obey the will of God. Fathers, far more important than your position, your popularity, your prosperity, far more important than any of that, dads, is your obedience to the will of God. And I would hate to know that as the leader of the Connor clan, that the blessing of God was missing from my family because obedience to the will of God was missing from my life. And some of us as dads, sometimes we just get so cotton-picking selfish. Think only about us, what we want to do. Daddies, every time we refuse to walk in the center of the will of God, it has negative reactions upon our families. So his family was blessed. They benefited. And then secondly, his followers were blessed and benefited because verse 3 says, and his men that were with him did David bring up, and every man with his household, and they dwelt in the cities of Hebron. Those that have suffered with David were now reigning with David. And they were blessed because his obedience to the will of God. Are we a blessing or are we a burden? You know, there are a lot of things in your life that I could not say, I know what the will of God is for you. I couldn't say that. But let me say what I know is the will of God for every person that's breathing in this place today. God's will is for you to be saved. That's God's will. Are you going to do it? Or are you going to delay? So that's God's will, for everybody to be saved. Are you saved? Do you know it? Do you know that if you were to die today, that you would go to heaven? If you were called to stand before the Lord today and He said, why should I let you into my heaven? What could you possibly say to Him? Are you lost? Do something about it. It's God's will for everybody to be saved. So if you miss heaven, don't blame God. It's not his fault. Secondly, it's God's will for everybody to be sanctified. After you've been saved and I've been saved, then God's will is for us to be growing in the Lord. Now let me ask you, what is the one, two, three things that are hindering you or hindering me from growing in the Lord today? Well, God's will is for us to be sanctified. So are we willing to give up that which is causing us not to be sanctified? God's will is for us to be saved. God's will is for us to be sanctified. God's will is for us to be Spirit-filled. How are we filled with the Spirit? By obeying the Word of God. That's what it means to be filled with the Spirit. God's will is for us to be stewards. We know that. That's what the Bible says. After I am saved, God would have me to be a proper manager of the finances that He has placed in my hand. And the way that I begin that is being faithful with my tithe to the Lord. Now, you know that's the will of God, but are you going to do it? Are you going to do it? God's will is for all of us to be servants. If we've been saved, God's given us a spiritual gift. And He wants us to serve Him with that gift. And we can't serve Him with that gift if we are not a member of a local church. So you know what God's will is. Now, will you do it? I've pushed us up in the corner today. And it's either do the will of God or rebel against the will of God. And why would we ever rebel against that which brings the greatest joy to our living? Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed. No one looking around. Just a moment, I'm going to pray, and then after I pray, the choir is going to sing. Our ministers will be standing at the front. And maybe someone is here just like I was when I was 21 years of age, and you need to take the step today and come and tell a minister, I want to be saved. They'll tell you the rest that you need to do. Someone is here today, and God said, I want you to use your talents, your gifts, through the First Baptist Church in Panama City. You need to join that church, and you need to do it today. Others are here, and there's some things the Lord is dealing with your heart about concerning your sanctification. You need to lay those things down today so they will not hinder your growth. But Father, we do thank You for Your Word that guarantees us You have a specific will for each of our lives. God, I pray that we would not quit until we know what that is, and then we would do it with all of our hearts. I pray for those who need to be saved, for those who need to be sanctified, for those who need to put themselves in a position where they can be servants, for those who need to be filled with the Spirit. I pray, God in heaven, that they would respond during this time of invitation today. In Jesus' name I do pray. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed.